The aspiration to understanding the world and being able to explain and predict world phenomena is connatural to human beings. Starting from Greek philosophers like Plato and Aristotle, philosophers for centuries reflected on how humans understand the world. We define science as a systematically organized body of knowledge. But how is such body of knowledge built? What methods do scientists follow? For centuries, what mankind called science mostly referred to beliefs that had no scientific justification, but rather came from religion, superstition, or unsupported statements. They were later found by science to be wrong. A well-known example of a wrong belief is the Aristotelian and Ptolemaic view, which placed the Earth at the center of the universe. The notion of scientific method, as we know it today, was born in the 17th century with the work of Francis Bacon, Galileo Galilei, and Isaac Newton. They developed what we know today as the scientific method. The scientific method required that research results should be supported by evidence-based argumentations, which must rely on careful observations of the phenomenon under study. We now briefly describe the main contributions to the development of modern science. Francis Bacon wrote the book Novum Organum, or New Method, in 1620, in which he argues that humans cannot just passively observe the nature to understand it. They cannot rely on luck of observations, but they need to be proactive and perform experiments. Experiments are actions leading to observations performed with the explicit goal of confirming or refuting a hypothesis that explains a given natural phenomenon. Bacon's ideas fully matured, both in theory and in practice, in the fundamental work of Galileo Galilei. Galileo Galilei was a physicist, an astronomer, and a philosopher, and is considered as the father of the scientific method, the father of modern science, according to Albert Einstein. He brought Bacon's thought to maturity and developed a systematic approach, which is based on observing, collecting, and carefully analyzing data about the phenomenon under study. The data are then used to derive whatever conclusions can be deduced from those data. He used experiments to disprove or confirm existing theories. For example, in his famous Pisa Leaning Tower experiment, he dropped two spheres of different masses from the top of the tower to disprove what people believed at the time, that heavy objects fall faster than lighter ones in direct proportion to their weight. A fundamental contribution by Galileo is also the equal importance of theory and application in research. He used tools and built his own tools to support his research, like his famous telescope used to observe the geography of the Moon, the phases of Venus, and the moons of Jupiter. In building his telescope, he was among the first to use the refracting principle to observe the stars. He also devised and improved a geometric and military compass suitable for use by gunners and surveyors, developed a new and safer way of elevating cannons accurately, and a way of quickly computing the charge of gunpowder for cannonballs of different sizes and materials. Finally, he devised engineering schemes to alleviate river flooding. In modern jargon, Galileo was both a scientist and an engineer. Galileo taught to us that a scientist should not try to use the data with the goal of getting evidence that would confirm previous knowledge or would conform to dominant orthodoxy or ideology. Rational argumentations must be used to arrive at whatever conclusions a careful analysis of evidence would suggest. Galileo was a man of high integrity. He did not hesitate to contradict the doctrine of the Catholic Church, which followed the Ptolemaic view that the Earth was at the center of the solar system. Galileo had to appear before the Roman Inquisition in 1615, and then again in 1633, he was accused of heresy. He was forced to recant his views and was sentenced to house arrest for the rest of his life. Galileo engaged also in what today we can call reach-out activities. He did not just speak to his peer scientists, but brought his revolutionary theories to society. He realized that scientists must disseminate the results of research to the general public, especially if they have a profound impact on society. And this must be done using a rigorous but understandable language. In a book titled Dialogue Concerning the Two Chief World Systems, he presents a discussion involving three men. One, named Salviati, advocates the scientific method and presents Galileo's astronomical views. Another, named Sagredo, takes a neutral position. A third, named Simplicio, holds firm on the geocentric Ptolemaic view of the cosmos. Although Galileo did not explicitly conclude that Salviati is right and Simplicio is wrong, all the arguments that refute geocentrism clearly emerge from his book. We now briefly introduce Isaac Newton's key contributions to the scientific method. Isaac Newton was born the year Galileo died. He brought the scientific revolution to its full glory. Some people consider his book, The Mathematical Principles of Natural Philosophy, written in 1687, as the most important book in modern history. It also paved the road for the extensive use of mathematics in research. Through mathematics, observations can be connected and abstracted into comprehensive theories. For example, Newton describes his theory, which explains and predicts the movement of all bodies in the universe, into three well-known laws of mechanics. Building on the foundations laid by Francis Bacon, Galileo Galilei, and Isaac Newton, philosophers and scientists continue to investigate the nature of science and how science progresses. We jump 2 centuries beyond Bacon to briefly mention the contribution of an important philosopher, Karl Popper. In his famous book, The Logic of Scientific Discovery, he argues that scientific theories are universal propositions that are conjectural and hypothetical in nature and can only be validated indirectly by reference to their consequences. Popper starts from the observation that no number of positive outcomes at the level of experimental testing can confirm a scientific theory, but a single counterexample is logically decisive. This demonstrates the superior role of falsification as opposed to positive verification. Popper goes on and defines falsifiability of a proposition T as follows. If T is false, then, in principle, T could be shown to be false by observation or by experiment. He then elected falsifiability as the criterion of demarcation between what is and is not genuinely scientific. A theory should be considered scientific if and only if it is falsifiable. History of scientific thought is a fascinating subject. Unfortunately, it goes beyond the scope of this course, and we need to limit ourselves to the essentials and stop here.